In this video, I want to try to give you an intuition behind negative frequencies. Now, there is quite a bit going on this GUI that I've created, but I'd like you to focus on the top middle panel for the moment. And what we're seeing is the evolution of the motion of the mouse pointer as it moves back and forth across the top middle panel. That evolution has been shown on the panel or the plot to the right. And we can see that a sinusoidal type signal is being created. And it doesn't matter if I move the mouse up and down or left and right. I'm getting a sinusoidal shaped waveform being produced in both cases. Now, if I was to move the mouse in an anti-clockwise direction in a circular motion, we can see a helix type shape or spring-like shape being created. What I'd like to do now is just explain what else we're seeing in the GUI. So I have a sequence of numbers here, which is a set of complex numbers. And we use these complex numbers to represent the samples or measurements of the movement of the mouse pointer as it moved around the center panel. So the last red dot corresponds to the last sample that was taken. So that's the largest red dot that's here. So it corresponds to a location of minus 0.6 plus 0.08i. Well, the second last sample is the second largest red dot, and it corresponds to a sample of minus 0.47 plus 0.45i. These sequence of numbers at the bottom correspond to the output of a filter. And the filter is given by this difference equation, which is really quite straightforward. It just means that the current output is equal to half the current input plus half the input two samples ago. So in other words, this number here can be obtained by adding half of this number with half of this one. Likewise, this number here can be obtained by adding half of this number with half of this one here. So it's quite a straightforward filter to implement. I'm also showing the magnitude response of that filter in orange here. So at DC and pi radians per sample, the filter is leaving the original signal intact in terms of amplitude. There are two significant attenuations, one at pi over 2 radians per sample, and another significant attenuation at the negative frequency, minus pi over 2. I'm showing the pole zero plot associated with the system or filter down here in the bottom left, and we can see that there's two poles. And you should be familiar with the fact that these are zeros rather than poles, but these zeros cause attenuation. So there's an attenuation in the frequency response at a location of pi over 2 radians per sample, and that's caused by this zero. And this attenuation here is caused by this zero here. And what I'm going to do in a little while is change this filter so we just have a single zero, and we'll see what the impact of that is. But I'd like to point out the last few things associated with the GUI. We have the frequency content of the input signal. So it's essentially the FFT of the complex numbers that we have. We've got the magnitudes. We take the FFT and get the magnitudes of those complex numbers and have those plotted in blue. I've also got the magnitude content of the output shown in red. So we take the last 50 samples. I'm only showing 10 here, but we take the last 50 complex numbers, get the FFT, plot the magnitudes, and that's what we're seeing here. Over to the bottom right then, we have the output of the filter being displayed. And we can see that for the case when the input isn't being changed significantly by the filter, which is the case here, because the output and the input look very similar, we can see that the output and the input look very similar in the time domain. So now we know all the different parts of the GUI. Let's go on to generating signals. So I'm going to go back to creating a sinusoidal type shape. And we can see, if we keep an eye on the frequency content, as I create this time domain sinusoidal shape, we have two frequency components being shown. In the frequency domain, we've got a positive complex exponential and a negative complex exponential. And from Euler's equation, we know that a sinusoidal waveform is the sum of two complex exponentials, a negative and a positive one. As I increase the frequency of the sinusoid, so I'm just going to try to increase the frequency by moving the mouse button or mouse pointer more quickly back and forth, we can see that the output is being attenuated by a greater degree. Just gone slightly too quickly there, but hopefully you get the basic idea. We can see that the output has been reduced. You can see that here. And if I was to move the mouse in the circular motion like before, we can see that we get a positive complex exponential, and that is associated with these complex numbers here. So if we take the FFT of these complex numbers, we see that we just have a single complex exponential, because that's what a complex exponential is. It's essentially a sequence of numbers, complex numbers, that represents this helix type shape. And if you haven't seen the video on visualizing complex exponentials, I'd recommend that you go see it. So if I was to move the mouse pointer in a clockwise direction, and we keep an eye on the frequency domain, we can see that the complex exponential is now a negative complex exponential, has a negative frequency associated with it. And if I was to increase the frequency of that, we can see that it's been attenuated significantly. And I think we'll get to the point now where it's going to be significantly reduced. Okay, so we can see down to the bottom right that the complex exponential has been reduced significantly. Okay. Now what I'd like to do is just remove one of those zero values. So I'm just going to have a negative attenuation. So what I mean by that is I have a single zero, and it's causing this attenuation at this location. Okay. So if I was to now move in an anti-clockwise direction, in a circular motion, and I'm generating a slowly varying complex exponential, we can see it's not been changed significantly. Okay. But if I was to rotate in the opposite direction, in a clockwise direction, and generate a negative frequency, we can see that it's been attenuated quite significantly. Now, let's think about what would happen if I go back to generating a sinusoidal type waveform by moving my mouse back and forth. In that case, I'm going to be producing a sinusoidal waveform, which will have a positive complex exponential and a negative complex exponential. But one of them will be attenuated by a greater degree. So what we should see is on the bottom right plot, even though the input is a sinusoidal waveform, the output is a complex exponential. And that's what we're seeing down there. So we can see that in the plots, in the frequency domain, the positive complex exponential isn't being reduced significantly. The red and the blue kind of match. But the positive or the negative complex exponential has been reduced significantly, which means that the output is just a positive complex exponential, which rotates in an anti-clockwise direction.